This is going to be great. We're back, ladies and gentlemen, live on the Philippe Matthews Show. Highly, highly, highly anticipated show with our good friend Kaba Hiawatha Kamene, known as the Panther Prince. He's the co-star of the hit documentary series Hidden Colors 1, 2, 3, and 4, star narrator of the international hit film Out of Darkness, which is written, produced, edited, and filmed by Amadeus Christ. Professor Kamene is the author of honoring Professor William Leo Hansberry, 1894 to 1965, an intellectual libation for the architect of America's African Studies Department. How are you, my friend? Welcome back.
My brother, thank you so much for this opportunity. This is a very special opportunity. Allowing me to have this time because we're going to talk about somebody. Everybody should know this man's name, William Leo Hansberry. He was the uncle to Lorraine Hansberry, the phenomenal writer, Lorraine Hansberry, of A Raisin Literary Works. Her father, Carl, and William Leo were brothers. From Gloucester, Mississippi.
Wow.
So that
wow. Now, before we get started, Professor Kaba, on William Leo Hansberry, you call this book
Conversation.
Okay, I think we're having some audio issues here. Hold on a second. There's a delay. Can you hear me, Professor?
Yes, man. You're very clear.
Oh, okay. Okay. Because you were coming in a little unclear, and I just want to make sure that we get all of the good stuff. Before we get started,
we're having storms here, by the way, brother.
Oh, is that what's going on? Okay. So we have. Okay, that makes sense. You call this book a libation. What is why do you call this book a libation to his life?
Because a libation, in the traditions that I have been brought up in, a libation is a moment that you spend paying homage to those when you are about to do something. And I am at the point in my own career now where I write a series of books.
Mm-hmm.
I've been encouraged over the, I would say, particularly the last 3 years to begin to write books. And one of the things that I wanted to do before I go into writing my books was to do a libation, was to pay homage to the individual who really guided a lot of the work that I do, which is Leo Hansberry said in his writings, he said it frequently. He said that because the curriculum, so to speak, on the African-American experience, and because these materials are scattered in periodicals, in books, in newspapers, in museums, it would take people to go out and gather all this material and bring it into one central location and then develop a curriculum centered around it. And then he said, after those individuals who do this achieve their curriculum, then they've got to teach teachers and parents and children this material. So it was curriculum development, which is the writing of what is needed, and then it's the teaching of others on how to teach it to others. And that's what I've dedicated my life to. And this is why it was so fortunate for me to have someone like Professor Clark in my life, who pretty much understood where I was going in my career, understanding his teacher, because William Leo Hansberry was one of his teachers. And when I was in the process of getting my first master's degree here in New York from Hunter College, I was doing my coursework and I was getting close to when I would have to start a thesis. So I began to think about the thesis that I would write. And so that is when Professor Clark said, well, you know, something that would really not only be a great paper, but would also help you understand the work that you have yet to do, try William Leo Hansberry.
Mm, mm-hmm,
And so that's how William Leo Hansberry was chosen. Now, I had written a book, a novel on Ethiopia. And I had read, when I did my research on Ethiopia, I came upon two books, Pillars in Ethiopian History, which was edited by a brilliant scholar by the name of Dr. Joseph Harris from Howard University, where he took Dr. Hansberry's papers, as many as he could, and he wrote a multi-chapter book using the notebook. He called it the Hansberry Notebook. I came upon a second book when I was doing research that spoke about Africa and Africans as seen by the ancient Greeks and Romans, also edited by Joseph Harris, taking the work of Professor Hansberry and writing a book on it. But Professor Hansberry himself never wrote a book. But these two books are representative of his writings. And that's what Joseph Harris did. So I was familiar with the name, but I never really understood the depth and breadth of this man in terms of what he had to go through to get to where he got.
Now you got a chance to meet his family and kind of be accepted in the family in a sense very early on. Talk to me about that those events, that process, when you really delve into Dr. Hansberry's life and really started to write about it and teach about it. Talk to us about the family.
Very unique story. See, this is why I believe in all things happen in divine order. That's why I don't question whether there's a creator or not, because I know that there is a creator because of things that have happened. Once I decided to write this book on Professor William Leo Hansberry, I was attempting to find people that would help me locate people I could talk to and interview on him. And one of the things that Dr. Clark had told me is that Professor Hansberry had two daughters who still lived in DC, Gail and Kay, but he did not have contact for them. And so I was in the process of finding a way to get to Gail and Kay Hansberry. The principal, when I was working in the school system, I was an assistant principal. And the principal of the school took me in and brought me under her wings. I have to give Dr. Annie Walensky a great deal of credit for much of what I've been able to do, because it was her help and her bringing me under her wing. Now, what's interesting is she has two sons. Age-wise, I fit right between the two of them. In many ways, phenotypically, we look alike. Complexion, color of hair, things like that. And so, in a sense, one was a musician and one was a photographer. In a sense, I was the son she never had, that she wanted to get into education. So, in a sense, she really had three sons, in a sense. And I was the middle one. Well, her musician son was sponsoring a musician at a local nightclub. And she and he, the son, invited me and my wife, Shari, to come to the club and check out the group, have dinner with them. So I said, fine. It was a dinner party. It was about 12 people on at this long table. So I was sitting at the table and, you know, just to make small conversation, we were talking to each other. And I had mentioned that, you know, I was writing a book in the process of doing my thesis and writing my thesis on Professor William Leo Hansberry, but I was just having trouble because I was trying to find Gail. Now, the man who was sitting right across from me was a very good friend of Gail Hansberry and went to Howard and studied under Professor Hansberry, and he knew her phone number by heart.
No way.
This is the truth.
Wow.
This is the truth. Wow. This is how I know things happen. I don't question things, my brother Philippe. I just stay obedient to the ancestors and to the creator, and they will make a way for you. And so why this book is so important and why this is a libation, you can sense why I have to do this before I even open my mouth. There's an African tradition, and I pay tribute to it, that when I'm ready to speak, I ask permission of the elders to speak. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of times we just get up and start talking. Mm-hmm. But there's another African tradition that even before you do libation, you ask the elder, may I have permission to speak? That's the type of respect that we have for our elders. And so the libation and Professor William Leo Hansberry becomes very important. Now, needless to say, I write down that number. I call and I speak to Gail. She is the older sister and probably the one that would be most responsible for Professor Hansberry's work. Kay is the younger sister, as dynamic as Gail, but I guess because of age and eldership, Gail is the one that I spoke to. Long story short, we arranged a time where I would come to Washington, D.C., which was in April 1984, where I would begin my research on this great man, William Leo Hansberry. And I would spend a number of days sitting with Gail and Kay, interviewing them. And then they allowed me to go down into his study. Mm. And I remember when I walked in, I'm walking down the stairs and I'm turning into the basement and I'm facing about 6 4-drawer file cabinets. And that's all of his work.
Wow.
6 file cabinets, 4 drawers each. And that was his work, filled with folders and writings and maps and lithographs and all sorts of information dealing with Africa. William Leo Hansberry literally did what had never been done before. So there was no book to go to. There was no map to go to. There was just a lot of information scattered around the world. I would only imagine that a man of his genius, what he would have done in the internet age.
My goodness, yeah, right?
Where he could just go into the British Museum on his computer, mm-hmm, or go mm-hmm. into the Louvre, or the German, or the Turin Museum in Italy, where he could actually see the documents right there. And so, for what he did something that had never been done before. In fact, Ernest Houghton, who was the curator and director of the Peabody Museum in Harvard that took William Leo Hansberry under his wing, is quoted as saying, there is no person alive that could supervise Professor Hansberry getting a PhD because nobody has more information on this subject than him.
Wow. Wow. Nice.
He couldn't get a PhD because nobody could supervise him because nobody had the information that he had. He had been able to go around the world in many different ways and be able to get the information necessary. And he and his students, which is in the book, the Symposium of 1925, mm-hmm. he had a conference in 1925 in June of 1925, where the students that had been his students since 1923, they literally created maps of Africa, maps of Ethiopia, of West Africa, dealing with topics that had never been dealt with in the world before. They did it themselves through the research. They created the graphs. They created the maps. Mm. These were his students. He was a phenomenal human being.
Wow. Genius, obviously. And that is why you call him the architect of American African studies.
Exactly.
There's exactly. No one else could have done it because, as you said, other PhDs could not supervise him.
Absolutely not. And his area of interest, which I found very interesting, and that's why I researched him when I was writing my book on Ethiopia, was the fact that he focused on Ethiopia. Now, the Ethiopia that he focused on is not necessarily the geographic location we know today as Ethiopia.
Interesting.
It is part of Ethiopia. Ethiopia, the country today, is part of a much larger Ethiopia. Ethiopia comes from a Greek word which means dark complexion.
Mm.
Okay, land of the dark complexion people. When the Portuguese first went into Africa, they called Angola, Mozambique, and parts of southern Africa, southern Ethiopia. When Homer talked about India, he called them Eastern Ethiopians. Because the Greek word Ethiopia, Ethiop, came into existence through the Greeks, of which all other nations at a later date would use. And so therefore, wherever you saw dark complexion people, they were called Ethiopians.
Hmm.
So the Ethiopia that we're talking about is the same Ethiopia that I'm looking at that I would consider to be Kush.
Mm-hmm.
Which I would say the concept of when I break down the curriculum, the first step is to look, okay, astronomy is first. Okay, that's before the Earth even began. But when you get on the Earth and you look at the human family, your first group of lesson plans ought to be on the origin of the human family in the Great Lakes region, which includes the countries of Kenya, Uganda, Tanzania, the eastern fringe of Congo, going into the Ituri forest of Congo, down into southern Africa. That whole area is what we today call the Great Rift Valley. Now, from here, Africans are going to use the Hopi River or Valley to be able to travel across the continent, north and south. And they're going to attach themselves to other rivers, other tributaries, lakes, and move across the continent.
Mm-hmm.
When they get on the Hopi and they travel north on the White Hopi or White Nile, traveling up, once they get into the northern part of Kenya, there's going to be an occurrence that's going to allow them to develop the higher forms of technology.
Mm.
And what's going to occur is as they continue, their civilization is going to grow and perfect itself. And as it perfects itself, it's going to find itself in the countries that we today call the northern part of Kenya, Ethiopia, Somalia, Djibouti, Eritrea, Sudan, and going right up into the northern, the southern part of what we today call Egypt. That's going to be Kush. That's what I call Kush.
Okay.
And what's going to mark Kush, now there are other views of this. I'm just using my view because I'm attaching Kush to technology. The southern part that I just spoke about, the Rift Valley,
mm-hmm.
that's dealing with the origins of the human family. The Australopithecus robustus, the Australopithecus gracile, the Homo habilis, Homo erectus. But once you start getting into that higher form of thinking, into the Homo sapiens and the Homo sapiens sapiens, you are now dealing with a technological people who are using their environment, because that's what economy is. Echo comes from the Greek word oikos, which means your home or your environment.
Mm.
So that economy, we think of economy as money, but economy isn't money. Money is an economy, but economy isn't money. Economy is when you use your environment to be able to push your civilization to higher levels of consciousness.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And as you can see what's happening with the economy of today, it is not doing that at all. It is not even doing it for the people that have most of the money, because they're not growing. In fact, they are receding in consciousness.
Absolutely. Fascinating.
So you can't even compare the way in which the humans are supposed to be developing mm-hmm. their economy to the way it's being done today.
Mm-hmm.
When we are robotizing everything and putting in the hands of machines that will never be as qualified as the human spirit.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And what Professor Hansberry was saying in his work is that he said he believed firmly that if peoples of African descent knew their history, they would pull themselves up out of the conditions they found themselves in, not by asking other people for help, but by helping themselves do it on their own.
Wow. Wow. Okay, so now that's powerful. Let's go back then. Here you are walking into Leo Hansberry's house where this man resided. You see these file cabinets. Gail ushers you in. What was the first thing went through your mind?
Where do I start? I remember that thought in my head because I was overwhelmed with what I saw.
Well, where did you start?
In the first drawer of the first file that was closest to me when I came downstairs.
Wow. Now, how long did it take for you to go through all of those files? Because I know you, and I know you did. Because I know Kaba Hiawatha Kamene. How long did it take you to go through that? And at some point, I mean, you know, doing that level of research on another human being and to do it on that topic, on the subject of your people, it must have been, I don't know, like an out-of-body experience for you. I mean, you must have literally, your cells in your body, your DNA must have absolutely changed on the spot. I mean, what was that journey like?
My neurons were reconnected because I walked back in time. I walked back into a world of 1921. Mm. And I began to realize the world that he lived in. Now that's going to become very important when I start teaching the course on Malcolm X.
Mm.
Because one of the things I came to realize was, as human beings, we're all born in the times that we are born in. The times that we're born in shape us.
Mm-hmm.
Our response to that shaping shapes the times that we're in.
Mm-hmm.
And so in observing the world of 1921, observing the world even of 1894 Mississippi, of two young black men losing their father. William Leo Hansberry was 3 years of age when his dad, Eldon, E-L-D-E-N, passed away.
Mm-hmm.
In a very angry world of white supremacists in Gloucester, Mississippi. What goes on in a three-year-old's mind? Well, he found refuge reading the books. His father, Eldon, was a professor at Alcorn A&M in Mississippi. And he was somewhat of a expert on the Greek and Roman world. And William Leo Hansberry remarked that in his father passing away and in attempting to hold on to the memories of his father, he would go and read the books that his father had in the library as he grew.
Uh-huh.
And he said that as he read these books from the Greeks and the Romans, that this word Ethiopia kept coming up.
Oh.
And he didn't know it in the beginning, but it began to be shaped that it was this world in Africa and that he was an African. And that it was the world that was never seen by most people. The same way Bobby Seale is talking about that should be taught in schools.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
Well, back there in the 20s and the 30s and the teens of Mississippi, you can imagine no history of black folk is taught. And what is taught is a very demeaning history, disrespectful history.
Uh-huh.
And so there is a desire for him to know of this mysterious land known as Ethiopia. And in 1916, William Leo Hansberry is going to be working in a cleaner's. And he's going to come upon a book in 1916 that was being advertised in Crisis Magazine, the magazine of the NAACP. There is a new book that's being published by a man by the name of Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois. And it's called The Negro. And in the subtitle and the advertisement, it talks about talking about kingdoms of Africa that heretofore have never been spoken of. So he orders the book and he reads the book. And that is going to be his third influence. His first influence was his father. His second influence was his mother, Pauline. The third influence is going to come from Dr. Du Bois in The Negro.
And in, your book, this is the chapter of the early years.
Yes, yes, because he's now going to be going to the school that we that was called Old Atlanta at the time. It's Morehouse now, but it was Old Atlanta then. He went part high school, part college. And when he went back for the courses, he asked the head of the social science department, Dr. John Bingham, where he could find these books on Dr. Du Bois's list, because he wanted to read every book. He needed to know more about Ethiopia and Africa. And Dr. Bingham said, well, these books, you're not going to find them. You'll find them at Harvard. You'll find them at Yale. You'll find them in the Library of Congress. But you're not going to find these books everywhere. And at that point, Dr. Hansberry decides to go to Harvard.
Wow.
To read the book on Du Bois' list. He's not going to Harvard because he wants to go to Harvard. He's going to Harvard because he wants to read the books on Du Bois' list. And when he gets to Massachusetts that first night, the first thing he does is go to the library and looks at some of the first books on Du Bois' list. In this case, it was a book entitled A Tropical Dependency by Flora Lugard. And he reads, he starts to read that book. The first thing he does when he gets to Massachusetts, first thing he does when he gets to Harvard, he's not interested in enrolling, he's interested in getting the books on Du Bois' list.
And so this is the chapter you talk about, straight college in early years at Howard.
Yes, that's going to go into the next chapter.
Wow.
Because in his time at Harvard, he's gonna have a lot of challenges, financial mostly. In fact, I have letters from heads of departments to various professors on behalf of William Leo Hansberry asking them if they will accept him in class, and they always mention he is a colored student.
Wow. So it's like that was the caveat. It's like, yeah, well, we've got this young kid here. He wants to come in or whatever, but he's colored. Because that was the word that they used at the time. Of that era, we were colored.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. It was an academic term.
Considered the PC version, because we know the N word was the colloquialism and So he was a colored boy that they used as a means to describe him as a preface before you just blatantly say yes, let him in.
Well, you could not let him in because they could refuse him. So they were really kind to trying to let the professors know that he was of African descent so that they could right there say whether they would accept him or not, because professors could say, I don't want him in my class.
Wow.
You're talking Massachusetts. Okay, you're talking Massachusetts.
What year is this, in the early years? Or in straight college?
You're dealing with 1917. Yeah. Even before that, 19, in that area, 16, 17, 18. And so he's going to Harvard in 1916, 1917. And what happens is that he has a lot of problems with money in order to pay for the courses. And so he waits tables and he does various jobs in order to pay for his, his college classes. But then something interesting happens. World War I breaks, but the United States doesn't get in it. In fact, the United States doesn't get into World War I until the end. Mm. William Leo Hansberry goes in. See, William Leo Hansberry was a thinker. And as you see him develop himself over the years, you're going to see him apply this unique strategy in his head. Phenomenal chess, because he could see the board in front of him. Mm-hmm. And by that, I mean life. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And he did things in order to make things. So the reason why I tell you this is because he's seeing something, because he knows that when he comes back after the world wars, he comes back, he realizes that he can get something known as the SB degree. Letter S, letter B. It's a special degree that's awarded to students at Harvard and probably other universities when the student has completed 3/4 of their coursework and enlisted in the war. Mm-hmm. He knows that with that SB degree, he can now teach and make money in order to be able to return back to Harvard.
Wow.
Why? To read the books on Du Bois's list. See, wow. I don't want us to get genius. Away from what he's doing.
Genius.
You don't care nothing about Harvard.
It was always a method to the madness, in a sense.
That's it. Everything he did was strategic. From 1916, he wanted to read the books on Du Bois's list to connect with that thought of Ethiopia that he read about when he was a child, because he knew that he would feel better about himself as a man and as a black man if he knew his history. So he goes to Straight College, which is now called Dillard in Louisiana. And he starts the first African studies department at Dillard. In 1920-21, he goes on different tours, teaching African history all along the coast. In North Carolina, Rocky Mountain, he comes upon a man by the name of Dr. Jesse Moreland. And he does a presentation. And after the presentation, Dr. Moreland comes up to him and says, "Wow, that's some really great information." He said, "I'm on the board of trustees at Howard University. And we'd be interested in you coming to help us shape a Department of African Studies, which we don't have, but we think you can handle it." Mm-hmm. So at that point, Professor Hansberry begins to put his sights on going to Howard to teach. Why? Because remember, one of the other places that has these books is the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C. And so he then goes to
So Howard. even him saying yes to teaching at Howard was part of his strategy.
Yes.
To get to the library, to get to access to the Library of Congress. So it was never just, "Oh, I'm going to take this job because it's just here and it's available." There was always, again, a method to his madness. That was fantastic.
Yes. But the creator had other plans at the same time. See, I believe the whole thing happened in order for him to start this journey in life. That's why I say, even from my own experiences, I know that everything, if you remain obedient to your heart, to your creator and to your ancestors, a way will be made for you to do what you're supposed to do. And so Howard became a place that not only could he get to Washington, D.C., but he would also be able to return back to Harvard to continue his work, to complete to get his degree, his bachelor's degree, and his master's degree. In fact, William Leo Hansberry did so much independent work that when he returned to Harvard, he was not only on track to get his bachelor's degree, he was on track in the master's program. to get a Master of Art in Anthropology. So that everything was laid out for him, because the people that he met along that road, he needed to meet. He just didn't need to read the books on Du Bois' list. That the books on Du Bois' list was like a mantra that a meditator uses to get to a certain level of consciousness. The books on Du Bois' list was like a mantra. It was what drove him, but in that being driven, he met and experienced things that would make him the great man that he became. So everything happened for a reason. Even though he wanted the books on Du Bois' list from Harvard, Harvard helped him. Because he met people at Harvard that helped him. And Ernest Houghton was somebody that helped him a great deal. Because he saw in Professor Hansberry, it went beyond color. It went to human genius. And when one genius sees another genius, color is irrelevant.
That's you absolutely notice it, true.
But it's irrelevant. It's irrelevant. And that's what William Leo Hansberry came upon, people who, no matter what the times they were living in, had an absolute respect for his attention to detail. And his writing style. And what he was willing to do, he worked hard for his work. And so he gets to Howard, and that is when I am going to interview Doris Hull. Doris Hull was the librarian at Howard, who was a student of Professor Hansberry in the late 50s and 60s.
Wow.
She was there when Kwame Nkrumah was there. And
What did, you know, we're going to stay on William Hansberry, Dr. Hansberry, but for you, did you, what was it like touching that level of history in real time? I mean, what was that, were you aware of what you were doing and what was happening at the magnitude of it?
Yes and no. Yes, because I recognized the genius in this man. But no, I never realized how it would so ably assist me in my life from the moment I did it. Because as we've spoken before, and we'll probably talk about it when we get into this interview, I also went through my own situation.
Right.
I went through my own odyssey, that as I was telling a story of a man who went through his odyssey, in my trying to tell his story, I went through my odyssey.
And let's do that, Professor, because that is one of the questions. And you know, when I started working with you on this book, and helping you flesh it out and put it all together so it can come out on Amazon and actually I didn't even know I was working with you on your first book, but it's now your first book and it's amazing. You shared with me a story that is still hard to believe, but it happened. But what was fascinating about your story and about your journey is the parallels to William Leo Hansberry, to Dr. Hansberry. There were so many parallels to his life and to your life. Walk us through those aha moments, those parallels, those pains, and the epiphanies as well.
In the New York City Board of Ed, I started working in the New York City Board of Ed in 1979. I had already began my non-matric program for my master's degree. Non-matric meaning that I wasn't going for the degree itself. I was just taking a course here and a course there. Started teaching. I was a substitute teacher, gym teacher, and by 1981, I was appointed. From the moment you're appointed in the New York City Board of Ed, you have 5 years to get your master's degree. And if you don't, you will lose your license. And that is when I began to quicken my pace, because I had until 1985 to get my degree. Well, 1986, 87 to get my degree. Because I was appointed in 81. I started in 79. But I wasn't an appointed teacher in 79. I was an appointed teacher in October of 1981. So I had 5 years to get my master's degree. And in having Professor John Henry Clark as my unofficial professor for my paper, because he wasn't part of the history department and I was getting my degree in history. He was the director of the Black and Puerto Rican Studies Department at the college where I was. I was in the history department. So he could not be my advisor. So I had to pick an advisor from the history department. And there was only one person that could be my advisor. And so I started this. And the paper that I wrote every year was rejected. Until I had to bring the professor in question before the board. Because if I didn't, I was about to lose my license.
How many times was it rejected?
It was rejected four times. Five times, but the fifth time, I brought him before the board.
And what was, well, okay, go ahead and finish that, because I want you to go back and walk us through, because I remember you sharing with me offline some of the stories where you confronted this man and just the vitriol and this was a really, really a bad actor. This was a bad player. Go ahead.
Well, I came to realize afterwards that after I got my degree, according to what people told me, whether this is true or not, I don't know. But I'm going to say what people told me is that not many Black folk got degrees in history from the college I went to. And I can understand why. Forget about African history. And you see, I studied European history. I did my paper on William Leo Hansberry. But my master's degree focused on European history because Dr. Clark said, I'll teach you what you need to know about Africa. Let them teach you about Europe. So I took courses like the German war machine, and everything that I did focused directly on the 19th century. Because it was there that Dr. Clark told me that was where Europe changed, was in the 1800s, straight through. And so I took the Victorian age, you know, find out about England. I took the German war machine. I took the beginnings of the seed of what would lead to world wars. I studied the Berlin Conference. That was what I studied as a history for my master's, but my paper was on William Leo Hansberry. And I took two or three courses on Africa and the world. But when I submitted my paper the first time, it was 200 and something pages. That was rejected.
Wow.
Too long. Okay, so then I brought it down. Another excuse. But one day I was in his home, because he never met me in the office. I always had to go to his home. I guess he felt more comfortable in his surroundings with me.
Or safe.
And safe, as opposed to being in a neutral place with me.
Right.
And one day, he must have forgotten that I was supposed to come. And I believe he had one too many for afternoon snack. And he said to me, it was really getting to the point where I was saying, wow, you know, I mean, am I going to get this degree or not? Because you're dealing with like the third rejection. And so he said, you know, I have to tell you, I admire you. And I looked at him. He said, because if someone did to me what I've been doing to you, I would have given up.
Wow.
And why did he say that? Yeah. The creator put those words in his mouth. Because I say, I'll be damned. I am going to get this master's degree. That was the turning point in this. When he told me that and I knew what he was doing, I said, it ain't going down like this. I'm going to get
play that.
You know, that's right. Homie, don't play that.
It was, as we say now, it's on.
Yes, that was it. That's what I needed to hear him say that.
Wow. Because I'm sure you were, for a moment, as anybody would maybe have some self-doubt. Maybe it is me. Maybe I didn't do it, you know, because it's not logical.
This man of European descent once said to me, he couldn't figure out how I got through college.
Wow. Really?
See, these are, you see, you know, for us as a people, for peoples of African descent who are struggling, who may not go to what we call formal college, formal education, people who have jobs in all different areas, the one thing that I can tell you is that no matter how high you rise, no matter even if you become president of the United States of America, the lowest of the low of Europeans still will think they're better than you.
Powerful.
And it's important that we as a people understand this, no matter where we are in our station of life. The Western world has the African person and the African man in particular. In order for them to feel good about themselves, they must place even the greatest of humans who are black in the lowest of positions. And this is what we live, and this is what I understand, and this is why I identify with our people universally, and I tell us I love our people unconditionally, because I know I'm in the same position that they are. I may have other things that they may not have, but when it gets down to the sociological view of me as a human being, I ain't nothing but a, I ain't gonna say it.
Yeah, we don't need to say it, but we know
as
what
as far as they're concerned.
Yeah. Wow.
That's what Malcolm said. Malcolm told us that. And so it's important that as we move forward with this work, that we don't seek to validate, be validated by them, because they never will validate you.
Yes.
And so that my doing this work on William Leo Hansberry was very important to me. But then when I was confronted with a statement like that, I realized in his name, I have to get this done.
Wow.
In his name, I got to make sure that the story of this man is told. So.
And he said to you that this will never see the light of day. This will, you should never publish it, or it will never be published, or something to that degree.
Well, I brought him before the department, and I needed three independent readers to read it. Somebody in the language department happened to be someone who spoke, who taught Spanish. Somebody in the anthropology department read it. And the dean of the social science department read it. Their basic response was, this is a good paper. I may not agree with what you said. They may not have agreed with William Leo Hansberry's perspective of Africans in world history. But they said, it's not my job to judge what he said. It is to judge the quality of your paper in saying what he said.
Right, exactly.
So they said, as it relates to a paper, it's a good paper.
Right.
I learned a lot about him, and you covered every aspect of what should be done. These are my conversations with him. However, I didn't know how it was going to work out. Now, you know, you're dealing with 1987 now. And so...
All of these people are non-melanated, correct?
Yes, these are all non-melanated. I'm not sure what the it was a woman in the Spanish department.
Okay.
The language department that spoke Spanish. It was a woman.
Okay.
what her cultural background was, of course, you know, black, but maybe not looking at herself that way.
Okay, sure.
But I to answer your question, I would say it's very possible, with the exception of the Spanish teacher. The other two, for sure. The other two were men. Okay. She was the only woman.
Okay.
And you see, the other thing is that the college I went to had very interesting demands. You had to not only, to get your master's degree, which is very seldom, I had to take a language proficiency exam, and I had to take a graduate exam, which is a cumulative exam. You do that for your PhD. You don't do that for your master's degree.
Wow.
And so I not only was proficient in Spanish, well, French was the first language that I took. So I took my test in French and in Spanish and passed them both. That might have irked them too.
You think?
Just a little bit.
Just a little bit. This is why, ladies and gentlemen, that you have to understand the context of this, why I am so honored to have Professor Kaba Hiawatha Kamene on the show, and why I've had him on the show probably more than anybody else collectively in the history of 25 years of interviewing people, more times, because he's a walking encyclopedia. He is the history maker of history, and that is something that I feel the reason why if anybody watches any one of the series of Hidden Colors. And you don't even have to watch the entire one of the two-hour documentaries. The moment that, and at that time before you had your comedic name, you were Booker T. Coleman. The moment that you come on the screen, you're riveting. And it is because of this genius, this level of education that you have. And I don't think a lot of people know your background, your history of how you came to be this prolific historian and teacher and with such a high level of authenticity. But I do think that most everyone who sees you says Kaba Hiawatha Kamene is the truth. And listening to your story as you're telling it, we're beginning to, I think a lot of people, I didn't know a lot of this, but I think a lot of people will now know, oh, now it makes sense. That's why he's such, quote unquote, that's why he's a badass. Go ahead, Professor.
Well, you know, to add to that, my brother, I thank you so much because of what I went through, he made me a better student. So when I talk about how things happen in divine order, I'm happy he did what he did now that I look back.
Sure.
He made me a better writer. He made me a better thinker because I knew every time I had a meeting with him, I had to work myself up in order to just go to his house. Figuring, what am I going to hear this time? What is he going to say this time? What do I have to go through in order to get approval of moving on to the next chapter?
Wow.
And so with this, I thought of William Leo Hansberry.
Sure.
And he gave me strength because I understood, look, if this brother went through what he went through, I have no right to complain. Because at least I have a department I can go to. He didn't have anybody. And so, late at night, about 12:15, I'm laying in bed in this very house where I am right now. In this room where I am right now. And I'm laying in bed and the phone rings. And I answer the phone because I'm wondering who's calling me at 12:15. And he says, he introduces himself. And he said, I'm just calling to let you know that your master's paper has been approved by all three. And so you will be receiving your master's in spring of 88.
Wow.
He said, but just as a parting recommendation, this isn't worthy of publication. So I wouldn't try to get it published if I were you. And I said to him, will I be getting my master's degree? And he said, yes. And I said, thank you very much. Have a great life. Hung up the phone. Because I wasn't even going to dignify that with a response.
Mm.
My point was, am I going to be able to keep my license and keep my job?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I don't care what you think.
Because
you're irrelevant right now. Are you telling me I got my master's degree? Because I don't care about nothing else. So, you know, my mother used to always say, she'd say Skip. Skip is my nickname. Skip, don't sweat the small change. At that point in my life, he was small change. He was of no relevance to me anymore. He was relevant as long as he had to approve it. But when I could take his validation or his approval out of his hands and put it into someone else, and they validated my paper, I got my master's degree. That's all irrelevant. I cared about.
He was irrelevant at that moment.
Now, let's go back a couple years. Because I was so concerned about my not getting the degree from this particular college, I started on my second master's degree in administration and supervision. Because I was an assistant principal, I had become the executive assistant to the superintendent, I had become director of programs, and I needed a degree in administration and supervision to somewhat show that I had some educational background in leadership. And so within that same year, I'm about to get my next master's degree in education administration and supervision. And my master's thesis on that was on William Leo Hansberry and how he actually had developed the African Studies program. So I've done two master's degrees upon which this book is the combination of them both.
Wow. Okay, this is, you know, wow. I joked on a previous show that I have another channel called Philippe Matthews Show After Hours, and on there I cuss. And when you were telling the story about this professor that was denying you four times and on fifth time you had to take him to the ward, and when you were sharing with me just now about the phone call that came in, I almost went to the Philippe Matthews Show After Hours and I almost cussed on this show because I was about to call him every kind of MF you could imagine. Wow.
But he was a blessing.
It's fascinating because, and I know I'm not the only one, but when I hear this story and I hear this of them, and we all have a story.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I'm saying about this? We all have our denial story, our having to prove story, having to feel worthy of story, having to measure up story and never do. We all have that story. When we and whenever we hear it, and we look at people, especially like yourself, that we hold in high esteem. I mean, right now, there's a guttural reaction I'm having right now. I'm feeling it physically in my breathing is labored. I'm just, oh, you know. Now this happened, you know, years and years ago, but that is what is necessary for us to feel so we can heal. It's necessary for us to share this, for you to share this story so we can heal. It's necessary for this book to be out and for people to download it and to get it and to read it, because you're going to see William Leo Hansberry's, you're going to see yourself in William Leo Hansberry's story, and you're going to now see Professor Kaba, and you're going to see just how connected we all are.
Yes. And we are all connected in this, and this is why I do what I do, particularly for our children. So that while one day they won't have to go through it, for those that will continue to go through it until that day comes, to understand that there is cause for celebration. And that becomes very important, because your character is built during times of conflict and controversy, not during times of comfort and convenience. Had this been just something I wrote in a matter of a year and was accepted, I would never have been able to step up to the plate and get on my A game, to get on my A plus game. I learned something. I learned it not because he wanted to teach me something. I learned it because I demanded of myself more than what I was willing to settle for. And as African people, my mother used to always say, is it fair? No, it ain't fair. But that's the life that you're going to have to live. And you're going to have to make a choice, Skip. Are you going to succumb to their power over you? Or are you going to overcome and become powerful over them? That's a choice. We can spend all of our lives, and all of us have a story. We all have a story, as you said. We all have a story of what we've experienced as people, as Black people in particular.
Right.
But the question becomes, okay, those are the cards that the divine dealt you. How you playing your cards? And William Leo Hansberry played his cards until November 3rd, 1965, when he died of a cerebral hemorrhage. But he will be forever remembered, because the book I wrote is meant to let folk know this man passed our way. And I thank the ancestors and the creator for making him part of our life. Because he made me a better person. And he'll make all of us a better people if we just understood our history and our culture and understood what it is to be who we are.
Now, in the book, you have photos that's in the book as well, because Gail shared with you never before published, and you still have a whole archive of, so I've seen some of them, a whole archive of this man's entire life of photos. We're going to probably put that in a book or something, or and create historical reference for that. But in this book, you have photos, specific photos, and you didn't do a lot, but you, the ones that you did in the book that you put in this work were very significant and relevant. What was the process that you used to put these photos in the book at pivotal points and times in Dr. Hansberry's life?
The three covers, on the cover of the book itself, you have three images of him. One is 1921, one is going to be 1932, and the third one is when he's in his 60s, somewhere during the late 50s, early 60s. Three different phases. Those pictures were used because of the nature of who he was at that particular time. In 1921, he was just beginning his career. That came from an announcement of this lecture series he was going to give on the East Coast, where he met Dr. Jesse Moreland. That's the first one, 1921. 1932 is when he had finally achieved and gotten his master's degree from Harvard University, and he completed reading all the books on Du Bois' list. And in 1959 to 1960, somewhere in there, I'm not quite sure of the date, that is when William Leo Hansberry now had achieved the greatest things that he searched for in his life. And so those are three pivotal points in his life that I use. There's a picture that I show of he and his family, his wife, Myrtle Kelso Hansberry, Gail and Kay Hansberry. There's a picture of Dr. Hansberry and Myrtle Kelso Hansberry together in Egypt, 53.
I remember that.
Then there's a picture when he's on a camel and they're on a carriage driven by a horse. And it is Myrtle Kelso. Well, Professor Hansberry's on a camel.
Right.
But Myrtle Kelso Hansberry, his wife, Gail, his older daughter, Kay, his younger daughter, are on the carriage. And then the other picture that I used was him teaching. And there is an image on the blackboard that's saying Quetzalcoatl. Now, the reason why I use that, and he's pointing at the blackboard, the reason why I use that is because to be teaching about Quetzalcoatl, you've got to be teaching about the African presence in early America. Because Quetzalcoatl is the Native American word, or the Mayan word, for bird snake. Quetzal means bird, Quetzal means snake. Bird snake was the royal lineage brought from Africa to America. And that's what Quetzalcoatl represented, the African imprint on America with the pyramids and with the Olmec heads. Quetzalcoatl was a representation that Dr. Hansberry had information that Dr. Ivan Van Sertima was writing about in 1975, and they came before Columbus. Professor Hansberry was teaching that to his students in the 60s.
Wow.
And so I wanted to show that. That word Quetzalcoatl is very important on the board because it represents how exhaustive his knowledge was of Africans in the world arena, uh-huh. including America. Uh-huh. And so those are the pictures I used. I did not get heavy with the pictures because I wanted my DVDs. I've done two presentations on Professor Hansberry. I wanted my DVDs to be the visual. Because remember, the reason why I'm writing these books is because I was told by knowledgeable people that I was missing out on a very important audience.
Mm-hmm.
Because as I've told you, my brother Philippe, and I've told other people sometimes, I see myself as a stronger speaker than a strong writer.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Speaking really is my forte. Things come naturally when I can vocalize it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But when I got to sit down and write something,
mm-hmm.
it's not that easy for me.
Mm-hmm.
I can speak it in a minute. That's why I went out and got Dragon Speak.
Right.
You know, because I can speak it and then I can rewrite it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But the idea is that I didn't want this to be so much visual as it is for the reading audience to be able to capture this information with pictures.
Mm-hmm,
pictures
mm-hmm.
are important. But this is my venture into writing books because books are very important.
Absolutely.
And I've come to realize that there are many people who want to read.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And so this is it, this is my part in the presentation as it relates to my writing career.
Well, I am excited and honored at the same time that I was born at a time when I could know and share a space and time with Kaba Hiawatha Kamene. You know, I look at my 50 years of being on the planet, and you always ask the question, what's your purpose? What have you done? What legacy do you want to leave behind? How do you want people to remember you? All of that kind of stuff. And, you know, I look at all of the brilliant minds and people that I have had the literal honor to share a conversation with in just for a brief moment of time. And I have to say, every time that I have a conversation with you, and my sweetheart, you'll meet her when you come to Sacramento. You're coming here for an event in August at the Sojourner Truth Museum. You'll meet my sweetheart. But every time you call me and she's there, she sees my face light up. Because Professor Kaba Hiawatha is on the phone. Because I always say, hey, Professor, what's happening? And you're always, Hotep to my brother Philippe. And as she sees my face light up, she just knows that I'm just going to go in the other room because I'm going to have a conversation. So whatever we were doing before that, forget about it, because I'm going to dedicate my time to this brilliant mind. I thank you for giving the world you. Because I know from interviewing so many people what it takes to give yourself to the world. And now, you know, you're giving yourself to the world in a different medium and a different format. And that is another level of yourself that you have to take time to replenish yourself and reboot yourself. So you're educating at another level, in another genre, in another way. That being said, can you, as we close this out, can you speak to us about the significance of the 1925 symposium that Dr. Leo William Hansberry produced? What was that historical reference like? Because this is a man that he gave it all away. I mean, he just gave, he died with nothing left in him. I mean, he gave his knowledge, his wisdom to the people, and it was absolutely amazing. Speak to us about that.
He was known as the father of African students. One of the reasons why so many communities of Ethiopian descent were able to develop themselves so quickly when they came to the United States was Professor Hansberry opened up doors for students of Africa to come here. One of his students, Nnamdi Azikiwe, first prime minister, first president of Nigeria. William Leo Hansberry's eulogy, Nnamdi Azikiwe gives Professor Hansberry credit for shaping not just his political mind, but his cultural mind to understand to return back to Nigeria to build Nigeria. Wow. Kwame Nkrumah, the first president of Ghana, was a student at Lincoln University in Pennsylvania, used to travel to Washington, D.C. to come to Africa House to sit at the feet of William Leo Hansberry. Chancellor Williams, the author of Destruction of Black Civilization, was one of my interviews. I spent time with Dr. Williams, and he said that Dr. Hansberry was vitally, and I use that word, vitally interested in you, not just your academic career, but your social career, your balance of your mind, how you feel about yourself. He took that being a professor to the next level of being a surrogate parent. Being there for the students, giving them everything that he had, going above and beyond what the so-called call of duty was. And he was like this from the very beginning of his career at Howard University, so much so that his students dedicated themselves. In fact, one of the intrigues in 1925 was the fact that they tried to get Professor Hansberry removed from Howard University. Yeah. And there was a European-American president by the name of Dr. Stanley Durkee. And they brought charges against William Leo Hansberry. Oh. And the students went into an uproar. And in that uproar, they created such a powerful event. Stanley Durkee was removed. Dr. Johnson became the president, and there has not been another white president at Howard University since.
Wow.
That was not just Professor Hansberry. That was the love that his students had for him. Mm. He not only remained at Howard, he not only had the white president removed, he received money to do this symposium, which brought together students who had dedicated their lives. Some students had over 100 pages in notes from his class.
Wow.
And they developed these various courses. In the book, we talk about the symposium.
Mm-hmm.
And I literally list all of the presentations that were made and who made them and what direction they took. And in this, it shows a curriculum development process that starts at the very early beginnings of humanity going straight through to the white man's burden, or what's called the white man's burden, going straight through to the Arab and the European slave trade.
Oh.
And every one of these students, under his guidance, developed their presentation around that. This was almost like a major conference where it was students that did it. He empowered the students to do this. He did not bring all these different faculty members. You know why? Because there weren't that many black folk had this information.
Right.
People that had the information were the students that sat at Professor William Leo Hansberry's feet to learn this.
Wow.
This is what the symposium of 1925 did. And then the chapter that follows the symposium in the book is dealing with his textbook that he never wrote, his textbook outline. So after we do his life, we then get into two various chapters that talk about his work and about his administrative abilities to be able to put things together.
Mm-hmm.
And when people start to see what he did during World War II, the relationship that he had with Haile Selassie, the very special relationship that he had with Haile Selassie, of Ethiopia. He was a strategist. He was a politician. He was a professor. He was a humanist. He was a father. He was a husband. He did it all. He did it all. And he is somebody that we all can look to for guidance. Mm-hmm. And if we all should be so lucky to be able to have completed all the different things in our lives that he was able to do as a human being, he did what all humans are born to do. He lived. And in that living, his legacy continues in this book, An Intellectual Libation to the Architect of America's African Studies Program.
If Dr. Hansberry,
and I am just so very happy and so very proud, and my brother, Philippe, I thank you also for all that you did to make this happen. Your guidance and your expertise in this area, it helped me tremendously. I have to say, you know, I don't ever want to say what would or would not happen, but certainly it would not have happened as wonderfully and as powerfully as it did with your guidance and your expertise in this area. And I've been telling folk, if you ever want to write a book and you don't know how to do it, just write the book. I got the brother Philippe Matthews you can go to. He'll do it for you.
He'll get it done.
You just do the book.
You just do the book. Do the work and I'll do the rest.
That's right. Because you know how to do it, brother. You know how to do it. And before I knew it, you were calling me, telling me, expect the word from Amazon. There I am on Amazon, and they say your book on Kindle is up.
And there's so much more to come. You have no idea what's getting ready to go down. It's a blessing. I can't even begin to tell you how much of a blessing this is. If William Leo Hansberry were alive right now, and you had an opportunity after all these years of honoring him, studying him, and with this book, what would you say to him? What would you tell him?
I would say, keep on keeping on, because it ain't over till we win. And the reason why I say that is because that's the message I got from him. When going back to the beginning of this interview, one of the things that I kept feeling as I read more about him, as I read his work, as I talked to people, but as I read his work, one of the things that kept coming to mind was him telling me, get the work done. And I think this is why I've waited so long to publish this book. Because I spent my life, after I got my master's degree, I spent my life developing curriculum and developing staff. So I literally started doing what he said should be done. And so I got the message of a very humble man who laid out everything for anyone who was listening and watching to be able to pick up. And the study guide that I send to everybody that asked me for it, that comes directly out of the symposium of 1925, but my version of it. Mm-hmm. Leo Hansberry didn't have access to Sheikh Anta Diop, didn't have access to Maulana Karenga or Jake Carruthers or Wade Nobles or Asa Hilliard. Mm-hmm. All of those scholars took William Leo Hansberry's work to the next level. I was able to benefit from their work having been impacted by William Leo Hansberry.
Sure.
And so I think that William Leo Hansberry being with us as we speak of him, because all you got to do is call out the ancestor's name and he or she will be with you.
Absolutely.
So William Leo Hansberry is aware that his work is continuing and is going to continue in the books that are to follow. But before I get those books in place, I have to pour libation for our ancestor, William Leo Hansberry, who made this possible, and to let him know that we remember you and we revere you and we honor you. And that's why we are honoring William Leo Hansberry. More will be done on him. There are other people who will write books on him, maybe through the impact that I may have on them to want to get into him deeper. Because there are historians. There are different types of writers. Mine is just a libation. Mine is a mentioning of a name, of cataloging his achievements, his life, his struggles. But there will be others that will follow. But what I want to do is just bring him to the attention of people so that folk understand that this man did live and this is what he did for us. And at the end, at the age of 71, visiting family, he went to the hospital with a very severe brain headache, which became a cerebral hemorrhage. And he joined the ancestors, November 3rd, 1965. Many greats died that year, including Malcolm X, who, by the way, used to come to his sessions in Harlem to learn Black history from William Leo Hansberry. And so there's a circle of knowledge here that we're experiencing. And this is a wonderful way to start my odyssey in writing and developing what I have experienced over the years. And I just thank William Leo Hansberry for being that model of person. And I thank Professor John Henry Clark, his student, who I was John Henry Clark's student, who directed me in the direction of William Leo Hansberry to do this, because he so appropriately knew where I was headed in my life. He just recommended it. And from that point on, I obeyed him. And here's where we are.
Wow.
And I thank you, Brother Philippe.
Man, I thank you as well, man. This is what it means to go back to move forward. I mean, this is absolutely fascinating. This is a beautiful, beautiful day. Thank you. Stick around with me, Professor, in the green room as we sign off. Ladies and gentlemen, Kaba Hiawatha Kamene, the book. The link to the book is at the bottom in the description. And YouTube. The book is honoring Professor William Leo Hansberry, an intellectual, 1894 to 1965, an intellectual libation for the Architect of America's African Studies Department. It is amazing to read, and what's even more amazing is the man who brought him back to life, in a sense, in the current times. Kaba Hiawatha Kamene. Thank you, Professor. We love you.
Hotep. Stay strong. It ain't over.